I think I'm gonna get started now. I just wanna say thank you all so much for coming. I really appreciate it, and I'm looking forward to sharing the work I've done with you guys in the past 2 years. For this lecture, I will be discussing bow technique and the Suzuki method, and how incorporating aspects of the Alexander technique can further enhance the work we already do. Alexander and bow technique are both really close to my heart. I have been studying Alexander for about 4 years. Well, not studying it, practicing it for about 4 years now. And it's kind of something that just has helped my everyday life and also in my cello playing. And bow technique is another thing that I've struggled the most with. I've been a tense player kind of all my life, and so Suzuki really helped me kind of reform my bow technique and shape it into what it is today. When I combined ideals from the Alexander technique with the Suzuki method, it really just immediately clicked for me and was kind of when everything felt like it fell into place. So to explore this topic, I will be starting by examining all the pieces from the books I'm being certified in, starting with Happy Farmer from book one. Happy Farmer is one I've worked with a few students on now, and they all kind of complain about it and they think it's really hard. And while I definitely agree with them on that, I see it as one of the most important pieces for bow technique in the Suzuki method as far as like book one goes. It's our introduction to slurs, and it's a special kind of slur because it's more of a hooked bowing or a detached slur. So you have to grab the string on both the first dotted eighth note or dotted quarter note and the eighth note, and it's a release and grab that we kind of developed from French folk song. There are more advanced string crossings in Happy Farmer, and we also taper the bow at the end of the phrase in preparation for the next one. The rhythm is similar to May song, so you can, if a student is confused by that, you can bring them back to May song, but it's really all about developing a more mature bow control and distribution. And the biggest challenge is putting all three of those aspects together. And the last thing is, it is the start of the scoop bowing that we will see in Humoresque. So that. And as the student gets more comfortable and as you're polishing this piece, It can move to more of an off the string or off the string bowing, but it's always starting on the string. And the middle part of gavotte is a lot smoother with the bowing. There are slurs over 16 notes, and those are developed from Hunter's chorus. So you have to practice, you focus on in the B section of gavotte bow distribution with slurs, and having a lighter left hand but still articulating. And you also have to switch this style in a short amount of time. This is one of the first times we see a really fast switch from pizzicato to arco. And the bow is starting to be used here a bit more maturely as far as bowing for character. And the students are picking up on, when you're doing listen and play, picking up how they should be playing. And also, we are developing in this a really strong sense of rhythm and relying on rhythm as kind of the structure for everything. Especially in the B and C sections, it's also used to really build kind of musical intuition and understand, like, really connecting with the music and connecting with the audience. Which you see in Long Ago, and we develop it from there. string crossings as well, but nothing like super challenging. There are not a lot of longer slurs, but the bow planning is necessary, absolutely. And this piece is definitely one of the hardest we have done so far, but usually the students, if we develop them properly, are up to the challenge by then. So the cello handshake and realizing that I was holding my arm totally tense the whole time, and I wasn't letting go of control as much as I should have been. And so I definitely practiced a lot, like focusing it with using the bow, and then also how we do with students and using markers and things like that. And really just taking to heart the emphasis on just feeling your body and kind of doing what it wants rather than forcing the cello upon yourself. You're bringing your body to the cello and kind of molding it in a way that works best for you. And so the emphasis on comfort at the cello is something I kind of really never experienced before I started my Suzuki training. And so the bringing the bow to the fingers and really thinking about just finding where is most comfortable for myself, and then building my bow hold off that, and using all the exercises like the Up Like a Rocket song and the bow walking up and down, and then like the gatekeeper and things like that, really kind of helped me just remind myself that this doesn't have to be done with tension, and there are other ways to do it. So then, now moving to the book five piece, which is Danse Rustique. I chose this piece also because it's super fun to play. I find that any student who gets to this level is like, yes, let's do it, come on, I want to play this song. And the bow stroke in it is marcato, like the Lily Gavotte in book two. It's a very energetic bow stroke, but there's also the scoop and release bowing we see in Humoresque. And just like Gavotte and Humoresque, there are really contrasting sections. So the A part uses that marcato bow stroke, and then the B section is longer and smoother, really using the student's entire bow, opening the full arm, and being comfortable with playing at any part of the bow. This is the middle section, especially demands a lot of artistic bow distribution and planning. And there's a lot of just sinking and saving the bow. Thank you. development. But I also chose to play it because it was the first piece I ever performed for my undergrad, like ever. So it's kind of cool to have it also round out my graduate degree. But in this one, it's basically all about artistic bow distribution and using an extremely slow bow while still being artistic with it and it's sounding good. You experiment with changing the contact point to be louder rather than changing the speed of the bow. We have a lot of the sync and save I was talking about, which was developed in Reval and Dance Rustique. And it's learning how to have a good bow control while still having good tone. It's also a further development of using your bow to communicate characteristic or the style and the character of the piece. And also changing the color for sure. You can experiment with playing higher and closer to the fingerboard when you want to be softer or have a different sound. And moving towards the bridge when you are in the upper positions. And so this is kind of where all we've talked about in the prior books kind of comes to fruition. Develop this earlier, but here's where we can really emphasize using bow technique or our bow for phrasing and style. And students pick up on that style from listen and play. The teacher demonstrates what is typical, and then the students develop their interpretations from that. And then once they're starting to understand that, we can emphasize like listening to other recordings and kind of allowing them to pick and choose what interpretation they find best. There's a lot of emphasis on, in Bach, there's always emphasis on lines and voicings and communicating different voice entrances. And so you can use your bow to communicate those entrances and having different styles of articulation or different colors for different voices. Issues. So that's how I found Alexander Technique, I was lucky enough that they offered a class in it at my undergraduate school, so I was able to take a full year of courses. Since then, Alexander has become a part of my daily life and is the main way I cope with my injuries and tension and performance nerves. I always had a solid understanding of Alexander and was able to use it outside of cello, but for some reason there wasn't, I couldn't make that connection to bring Alexander Technique into my cello playing. And it really wasn't until Suzuki that I began to see aspects of Alexander in my training, and also I started to be able to incorporate the ideas behind Alexander into my own playing, which is, I found most beneficial with my bow technique, and so that's why I chose my lecture topic. So I don't want this to seem like Alexander Technique is the focus of the recital, but I feel like I should give a little bit of background. So Alexander Technique was created by this Australian man named F.M. Alexander. He was a Shakespearean actor and would tour around the world reciting Shakespeare's poems and sonnets and things like that. And he had issues with his voice going hoarse before performances. And so he went to doctors and vocal experts, and everyone gave him solutions that were like, just rest your voice until you have to use it and things like that. And he found that didn't work. So once he got really frustrated with that, he started to focus on himself and so he looked in the mirror while he was reciting one day, and he noticed that he would like force his head down and have his neck at an awkward angle, and that would kind of constrict his vocal cords. So upon this, he put together that it was a response to nerves, because whenever he was reciting got more challenging, it started to get worse and he started to lose his voice. So this discovery of his body's habits and the response to nerves became the basis for Alexander Technique. There are a lot of aspects of Alexander Technique that can be talked about this lecture could go on for 3 hours if I wanted it to. But to keep it brief, I will focus on the parallels between the Suzuki method and Alexander Technique. So the first aspect of Alexander that I'd like to talk about is called the whole self. And the whole self is this idea that every part of the body is connected. A quote that's used often is, the part reflects the whole. And so if you're like tense in your neck, you're gonna be tense in your finger and things like that. And it's just used to remind Alexander students, like, you have a body. And that you should pay attention to it. Because there's also, Alexander found there is a lack of connection humans had between their mental and their physical self. For example, like when I was first injured, I was in pain, but I was like, no, it's fine, it'll be fine, it'll go over and it'll end in like a day. And it didn't, and because I didn't really listen, it developed into something a bit worse than it should have. So it's really just about remembering that every part of your body is connected, and also that your brain is also part of your body and it's not some separate thing. And I see this in Suzuki as the connection we create for students with their cello, so that the cello becomes basically part of themselves and you treat it as one unit rather than a separate thing, as well as the Suzuki's belief that through this method, the reason we practice this method is to create a noble person rather than just an instrument player. So then the next thing that is connected to the use of self, or connected to the whole person, is the use of self. And the use of self first starts with noticing what your body does and learning the difference between good use and bad use, and developing a body awareness of like what you're doing. So, like, for example, the first thing I did in Alexander was this thing called active rest, where you lay on the ground with your knees bent so your feet are flat on the floor and your hands on your rib cage, and you just kind of, you lay there and just notice what parts of your body are in contact with the floor. And noticing, most people will notice like they have a severe arch in their back the first time they do this. And so you just notice what your body's doing, and then you start to think about over time, like, why am I doing that and how can I fix this? Like, I noticed that when I did active rest, I would clench my jaw like unnecessarily, and so I started to really think about that, and just, it's all a process of just kind of thinking. And the use of self, I see in the emphasis on body balance in pre-Twinkle students. We teach them how to feel and hear good use, and we make them comfortable at the cello while teaching them the good use habits. So the next part of Alexander technique I want to talk about is called inhibition. And I see inhibition as just choosing not to do something. So to get myself and my classmates started on this idea of inhibition, my teacher suggested that in the mornings when we're brushing our teeth, brush your teeth with your non-dominant hand, or put your socks on with your non-dominant side first, and just kind of noticing the habits we have and asking ourselves, like, well, why am I doing it that way? I can brush my teeth with my left hand. That's not crazy. But it's just the habits we get into, and so that is the aspect of choosing not to do something. And I see this especially in Suzuki in the cello handshake, and we are asking students to choose not to hold up their arm and just allow their arm to be free and the bow to be held without any tension. And students, they have to choose not to be holding tension. And obviously we don't say, okay, choose not to do, because that will make no sense to them. But in the simpler words, I see that as we are asking them to kind of put forth some inhibition. Then I also see this in listen and play, because when we do listen and play, we're asking students to delay their response to just want to play and jump into things, and instead we're asking them to listen to what we are playing for them, and then they can choose to do. The next part of Alexander technique that is usually paired with inhibition is called means whereby. And means whereby is waiting before completing an action in order to ensure it is done with total body awareness and good usage. It is basically just a step-by-step process to ensure that you're doing everything with good use. There's like a mantra that was started in Alexander that I use. I should use it more than I do, but it's basically like, when I'm sitting before I start playing cello, I say, my feet are flat on the floor, my back is long and wide, my shoulders are free, and my head is forward and up. And I choose to play cello without tension, or I choose to do something without tension. And this is kind of just a way to remind ourselves to be free and without tension. It gives us a habit. And I see means, I don't, like, there's no specific technique in Suzuki that I see this, but we do this with students all the time by giving them checklists to set up their bow hold or set up before they play. We ask them to check in with their feet, make sure they're rooted on the ground, and that their back is nice and tall, and they're not being pushed back. And so we just give them this checklist to check in with themselves. And so that's how I see that relating. And the mantra that I said is based off this this technique, which, or not technique, it's a term called primary control. And primary control is the relationship of the head, neck, and the back. And it's what basically all the exercises in Alexander technique are based upon. So every time you do something, like one of the focuses is getting up from a chair, you think about what your head, your neck, and your back is doing, and if one, if your head is bleeding, if your back is bending, and things like that. And that is where the mantra stems from. So you come up with something that includes your head, your neck, and your back. The next thing that I don't really see in Suzuki, but I think it can be really useful for teaching students is called faulty sensory awareness. And faulty sensory awareness is basically the misconception that you are using your body in good ways when you're really not. And this is born out of habit and an incorrect understanding of one's body. So, for example, in my own playing, I didn't really think I was squeezing with a thumb. And then I slowly realized, like, oh, I am totally squeezing with my thumb. And it can be used to kind of explain the misconception, the bad habits students can have, and kind of show them, like, oh, hey, you're actually not sitting tall, or you're actually not doing these things. And then the final kind of term from Alexander Technique that I want to talk about is called end gaining. And end gaining is simply just focusing on the results rather than the process. It's almost always the cause of misuse, and it's simply just only really caring about the end rather than the process you go through to get there. And I see that in students, I see that in myself. I did that for this recital occasionally. And so it's a really easy habit to fall into because we're always so focused, like, oh my God, we have to be successful, we have to do this. And it's like, but you have to be in the moment and just kind of remind yourself, like, but this is more important than that. And I see this in Suzuki by focusing on the teaching process and the students' learning process and our goal being to create noble people and good humans rather than just creating a really good cello player. So then there are a couple of concepts of Alexander Technique that don't really have any like names or are defined, but they can really relate to the Suzuki method. Like Dr. Suzuki, Alexander believed that anyone can learn his method and that it could really change the world. Both Suzuki and Alexander share the belief that good training is key in understanding and using their methods. But the reason I was drawn to both of these methods and why I see them working so well together is because they create fearless human beings. For a person to truly understand Alexander Technique, they must first accept that it's okay to be wrong. We must learn to see failures as our greatest teacher instead of our greatest enemy. And making mistakes is how we grow as people. This removal of fear of failure gives Alexander students courage to try new things and to experiment with their body and really pay attention and take risks. Suzuki does the same through creating this learning environment where children feel accepted and supported and loved. They don't fear performing because they do not fear making mistakes, and they've been playing in front of people since they began their training. And the parents and teachers are a key aspect of that because their support and patience is really what creates this environment. So when I started my graduate degree here, I was feeling really disconnected from the cello. I had pushed myself insanely hard in undergrad, as everyone does, but I was lacking a lot of positive feedback, and so that kind of really made me start to just lose interest in what I was doing. So I came to part not really knowing if this is what I wanted to do, or if it was just because, like, you have to get your master's, like, might as well do it. But then once I started my Suzuki training, it really helped me kind of find that love for playing cello again and find that positivity and that it's okay to make mistakes and it's okay to have failures because that's how you learn. And Suzuki has really helped me in as a player, a teacher, and just like a person in general. It reminds me constantly to just not be so hard on myself and allow myself to learn properly, and that I'm always learning. And So I think because of my Alexander Technique training, I was really able to use that to help my physical sense and my playing. And then also Suzuki was where I started to really just change my frame of mind completely. So I'll leave you with this quote from Dr. Suzuki's Nurtured by Love. A seed is planted in the earth. We don't see when the germination begins. That is the doing of Mother Nature. It is the fundamental working principle. We have to wait patiently. We cannot dig up the seed to see whether it's really growing. To do so would be to destroy everything. Thank you.